And this is lecture number 3 of chapter Monopoly. And the topic is the welfare cost of monopoly. In contrast to competitive firm, the monopoly charges a price above the marginal cost. From a standpoint of consumers, this high price makes monopoly undesirable. However, from the standpoint of the owners of the firm, the high price makes monopoly very much desirable. So when there is a monopoly, prices are high, and from consumers' point of view, monopolies are undesirable as prices are high. And from producers' or owners' point of view, monopolies are desirable because owners are getting high prices and profit also. So coming to next slide, that is about the efficient level of output. Here we can see that how can we determine the efficient level of output, and this is explained by the help of this figure. Here you can see that quantity is measured on x-axis and price is measured on y-axis. There is a demand curve which is downward sloping, this one, as usual, and also we have a marginal cost curve, this one, and both of these two curves intersect at point E, this point, and this point is known as efficient quantity, where marginal cost curve intersects the demand curve, and demand curve here tells the revenue of the firm also. So we can say that point E is known as the efficient quantity because at this point the demand curve is intersecting the marginal cost curve here. If we look below this level on this hand side, the value of the good to the marginal buyer exceeds the marginal cost of making that good. That means value to buyer is greater than the cost to sellers. As you can see here, that value to buyer is greater than cost to monopolist. So increasing output would raise the total surplus. And above this level, that is on this hand side, the value of the marginal buyer is less than the marginal cost. This means that value to buyer is less than the cost to sellers. And it's obvious from this side as well that cost to monopolist, this one, the marginal cost, is higher than the value to buyers. So decreasing output would raise the total surplus. So these are two extreme possible points, and they are not the efficient points. Like this side and this side, these two sides are not the efficient points. And the efficient point is where a marginal cost intersects the demand or revenue curve of the firm, and which is point E, and that is known as the efficient quantity as well. Next is the dead weight loss. When we talk about the welfare cost of monopoly, there comes the concept of dead weight loss to the society. Because a monopoly sets its price above marginal cost, it places a wedge between the consumer willingness to pay and the producer's cost. And this wedge causes the quantity sold to fall short of the social optimum. And we will discuss that phenomena with the help of diagram in the next slide as well. So coming to this slide, the inefficiency of monopoly. In this figure, we are going to measure the dead weight loss here. So a quantity of the product is measured on x-axis and price is measured on y-axis. There is a monopolistic demand curve which is downward sloping, as you can see here, and there is a marginal revenue curve and marginal cost curve as well. This is the marginal cost curve, and this downward sloping is the marginal revenue curve of monopolistic firm. As per profit maximization rule, profit of monopolistic firm is maximum at a point where marginal cost intersects the marginal revenue, and this is the profit maximization point where the marginal cost curve intersects the marginal revenue curve. This point at monopoly quantity and monopoly price. If talking about society or the social optimum point, we can say that it is that point where marginal cost curve intersects the demand curve. This one, this point is known as the social optimum point, where the demand curve intersects marginal cost curve, and this point is known as social optimum point or the efficient quantity. Monopolist should produce efficient quantity of output which is bigger than monopoly quantity. As you can see here, the monopoly quantity is that much, while the efficient quantity is bigger than monopoly quantity. So a monopolist should produce efficient quantity of output which is bigger than monopoly quantity, and here the price is also low as compared to the monopoly price. You can see here this one. At efficient quantity, the price is also low as compared to the monopoly price. But since the firm is monopolistic and it is the single seller of a product in the market, so it is charging higher price and supply less quantity of a product in the market. And the dead weight loss is represented by the triangle between the demand curve and the marginal cost curve. This shaded triangle is known as the dead weight loss. And this is due to inefficiency of monopoly, as they are charging higher price and supplying less quantity than the socially efficient quantity of output. So the difference of the efficient quantity and the monopoly quantity, and due to which there comes the dead weight loss. So this triangle is known as the dead weight loss. And it is due to the inefficiency of monopoly, as they are not efficient here and charging higher price and supplying less quantity than the socially efficient quantity of output. Now comes the monopoly's profit, a social cost. The dead weight loss is caused by a monopoly is similar to the dead weight loss caused by a tax. So here we are going to discuss the dead weight loss caused by monopoly, which is similar to the dead weight loss caused by the tax that is imposed by government. So the difference between the two cases is that in terms of tax imposed by a government, here the government gets the revenue from the tax, whereas a private firm gets the monopoly profit in terms of deadweight loss. You can see here. So the next slide is public policy toward monopolies. Government responds to the problem of monopoly in one of the four ways. First is making monopolized industries more competitive. Second is the regulating the behavior of monopolies. Third way is by turning some private monopolies into public enterprises. And the last one is by doing nothing at all. And we are going to explain all of these four ways one by one in detail in next slides. So the first one is increasing competition with antitrust laws. Antitrust laws are collection of statutes or laws aimed at curbing monopoly power. So by introducing antitrust laws, government can control the monopoly power. Antitrust laws give government various ways to promote competition. In any of the three ways, that is, they allow government to prevent mergers, they allow government to break up companies, and they prevent companies from performing activities that make market less competitive. So coming to the next policy. Okay, now again, the increasing competition with antitrust laws. Here are two important antitrust laws passed by American government. First one is Sherman Antitrust Act 1890. It reduced the market power of the large and powerful trusts that were viewed as dominating the economy at that time. And the second one is Clayton Antitrust Act that is passed in 1914. It strengthened the government's power and authorized private lawsuits. As the U.S. Supreme Court once put it, the antitrust laws are a comprehensive charter of economic liberty aimed at preserving a free and unfettered competition as the rule of trades. So these two antitrust acts are the examples of antitrust laws which were passed by American government in 1890, that is the Sherman Antitrust Act, and another one is the Clayton Antitrust Act that was passed in 1914. So now comes the second way, that is the regulation. So here government may regulate the prices that the monopoly charges. The allocation of resources will be efficient if price is set to equal marginal cost. In practice, regulators will allow monopolists to keep some of the benefits from lower cost in the form of higher profit, a practice that requires some departure from marginal cost pricing. So coming to this slide, marginal cost pricing for a national monopoly, as we have discussed in the previous slide. So this figure is trying to explain the marginal cost pricing for a national monopoly. Because a national monopoly has declining average total cost, this one, it has the declining average total cost curve, and marginal cost is this one, this horizontal line, that is the marginal cost and it is less than the average total cost. Therefore, if regulators require a national monopoly to charge a price equal to the marginal cost, price will be below the average total cost curve. So if you look here, that the marginal cost curve is below the average total cost curve, and the monopoly will lose money. So here the monopolistic firm is facing loss. This shaded area is the loss of monopolistic firm. And if regulators set price equals to marginal cost curve, you can see here that this is a price. When it becomes equal to the marginal cost curve, then the national monopoly will lose money and will face a loss. Now, next one is public ownership. Another way to control the monopoly is the public ownership. Rather than regulating a national monopoly that is run by a private firm, the government can run the monopoly itself. For example, in the United States, the government runs the postal service, and in Malaysia, the government owned and operated utilities such as telephone, water, and electric companies prior to 1990. So this is another way to control monopoly in terms of public ownership. And the last way is doing nothing. Government can do nothing at all if the market failure is deemed small compared to the imperfections of public policies. If the degree of market failure is small, then the government cannot intervene and they allow the market to work as it is working. So the next concept is price discrimination. Price discrimination is the business practice of selling the same good at different prices to different customers, even though the cost for producing for the two customers are same. When seller is charging different prices of same products to different customers, so this is known as price discrimination. As it's evident from its name as well, price discrimination, that means that the seller is charging different prices of same product to the different customer. Next is the analytics of price discrimination. Price discrimination is not possible when a good is sold in a competitive market, since there are many firms all selling the product at the market price. In order to price discriminate, the firm must have some market power, and it's possible in the case of monopoly. And the next very important term is perfect price discrimination. Perfect price discrimination refers to the situation when the monopolist knows exactly the willingness to pay of each customer and can charge each customer a different price. So this is known as the perfect price discrimination. Again, there are two important effects of price discrimination. First is it can increase the monopolist's profit, and the second one is it can reduce debt weight loss, and we will explain these two important effects of price discrimination in the upcoming slide with the help of figure. And the examples of price discrimination are movie tickets, where the a seller of the tickets are charged different price to different customers. Other is the discount coupons, airline prices, quantity discounts, and financial aids. So these all examples come under the category of price discrimination. So this is welfare with and without price discrimination. Here, let's assume that monopolist can price discriminate perfectly, as we have already discussed the perfect price discrimination, and that is, it describes a situation in which the monopolist knows exactly the willingness to pay of each customer and can change each customer and can charge each customer a different price. In this case, the monopolist charges each customer exactly his willingness to pay, and the monopolist gets the entire surplus in every transaction. If we talk about the monopolist with perfect price discrimination, in which he is going to charge the price that is exact to the willingness of the buyer, so in that case he is going to earn more profit. So this figure shows the producer and consumer surplus with and without price discrimination. If looking at figure A, this one, a monopolist with single price, when the monopolist charges a same price to all the consumers, because some potential customers who value the good at more than the marginal cost do not buy it at this higher price, so the monopoly causes a debt weight loss here. So you can look here that the area under the demand curve is divided into three different portions. This triangle is the debt weight loss, and this triangle is the consumer surplus, and this small portion is the profit of monopolistic firm. And if looking at the figure B, when a firm can perfectly price discriminate each customer who values the good at more than the marginal cost, buys the good and is charged his willingness to pay. Mutually beneficial trades takes place here. There is no deadweight loss, and the entire surplus derived from the market goes to the monopolist in the form of his profit. So you can see here that the area under demand curve is the profit earned by monopolistic with price perfect price discrimination. And also you can see here that the quantity sold as well, which is larger than monopolist with single price. So here we can conclude that when monopolist is charging different prices to different customers, he is earning higher profit as compared to the situation when he is charging same price to different customers. So in this case, he is charging the same price, so his profit is smaller as compared to the situation where he is charging different prices to different customers, and here the profit is much more as compared to the profit in single price.